Rosemary Radford Ruether is known for her many writings that cover a wide range of topics. Stay tuned as we look at how the life and work of Ruether came together to create the significant impact that she has had on both academia and public life. In this video, we are not only going to be looking at the life of Ruether, but also outlining some of the key theological contributions that she has had throughout her life. Hey there, if this is your first time to the channel, this is Christian Biographies, and we are focused on creating informative and accessible introductions to Christians who have impacted the faith throughout the past 2,000 years. If you like what we are doing, why don't you hit the like and subscribe button below? And with that out of the way, let's get to today's video. Rosemary Radford Ruether was born November 2, 1936 in St. Paul, Minnesota, and was the youngest of three daughters. Her mother was Roman Catholic, her father was Episcopal. But Ruether says that she was raised in a free-thinking and humanistic upbringing as opposed to an oppressive atmosphere. At the age of 12, however, her father passed away and her family moved to California. Ruether's foundational years were spent surrounded by strong women. Her school was staffed by the Sisters of Providence from St. Mary of the Woods, and her mother had many friends who offered her a strong feminist and activist foundation. These would be the building blocks upon which the rest of her life would be built upon. In 1954, she began her undergraduate studies at Scripps College. In 1958, she graduated with a bachelor's in philosophy and began her master's works at Claremont School of Theology. With some help from one of her professors, she focused in on historical studies. Specifically, she got her master's in Roman history in 1960. Afterwards, she began her doctrinal work, which she finished with a Ph.D. in Classics and Patristics. Throughout her life, she would also go on to receive numerous honorary doctorates. At this time in her studies, she also married Herman Ruether and had three children. Early on after her schooling, during the 60s, Ruether became very involved with the civil rights and activism in Mississippi and Washington, D.C. She worked with Delta Ministry, where she was introduced to the struggles of African-American communities and the realities of racism. It is here that her lifelong passion for the marginalized and oppressed began to unfold. Her experience in Delta Ministries, as well as the attention to injustices in Latin America, sent her on her educational efforts to address these very important issues. One scholar said, "Rosemary's public practices of theology is a model to emulate. It is at once intellectually rigorous and grounded in daily experiences." After her work with Delta Ministry, she began teaching at Howard University School of Religion. She taught for 10 years at Howard from 1965 to 1975. In 1976, Ruether started teaching at Garrett-Evangelical Seminary near Chicago, where she spent the bulk of her career. Since then, Ruether's also spent a lot of her life visiting and guest speaking at many educational institutes. But far and away, the most influential part of Ruether's life has been her countless writings and her foundational theological beliefs for many. You can check the Show More tab below to see all of her works, but she has written over 40 books and over 600 articles up to this point. Ruether has been foundational in feminist theological works within biblical studies, but her reach is far beyond just feminism. Her focus on ecological importance, gender studies, the Bible, Christianity, and many other theological grounds is what makes her foundational for many liberationist studies. But one thing that set her apart from other radical feminists was that she never left the church. Although she was critical of it, her first book actually being a critique of the church, she believed that the organization needed to be restored to a new organization, not just thrown away. We are now going to turn to an overview of the theological beliefs that define the work of Ruether. These are only going to be a brief introduction, but serve as a basis to why Ruether's work has been so influential in the feminist movement. An essential book in any feminist studies is Sexism and God Talk by Ruether. It is a classic text that examines the systematic treatment of the Judeo-Christian tradition from the standpoint of feminism. Her belief is that there has been a suppression of women's rights and a corruption of equality throughout church history. The overarching theme of Ruether's work can be described as feminist theology, and although that may be a little too constrictive for Ruether, since she has written on such a wide range of issues, for the sake of simplicity, you can consider this the vein of her theology in which all other things flow through. Highly critical of the patriarchy present throughout the church history, She introduced a skepticism upon which all history has been recorded and understood. She believes that to create an equal atmosphere of knowledge and understanding, there has to be a rejection of anything resembling the patriarchy and the results of it. As we go throughout the rest of her theology, you will see how the belief in the suppression of the marginalized and the current focus of women's point of view in studies is a basis of her beliefs. Overall, Ruether's contribution to feminism states that when anything suppresses or goes against the experience or complete freeing of women, it needs to be changed or rejected. Another focal point for Ruether was the ecological issues propagated by many in a failing effort to expand humanity's domination of planetary resources. This type of thinking has been labeled eco-feminism, since many see critical connections between the domination of nature and the exploitation of women. This is a wide-ranging topic, but Ruether is most known for her critique of three failed responses and her unique answer to the issue. Ruether wrote in To Change the World, Christology and Cultural Criticism, that there are three failed responses to the current relationship between humanity and the planet. She labels them the liberal progressive response, the Marxist response, and the romantic response. These responses look to science, change in ownership, and the rejection of modern advancements to create their own unique response to the problem of expansion and corruption of the resources. Ruether points out that all these either leave the issue they label as side effects, which are detrimental to the society, or they neglect to answer the actual social and natural domination of these areas. She states that the social change needs to be a conversion back to the center, like the biblical idea of Jubilee. The return to harmony in the covenant of creation is not a matter of cyclical return to the same, for each new achievement of workable balance is different, based on new environments and technologies. Thus, there is room for genuine creative development without the necessity for infinite expansion. We turn now to one of the most noticeable creations of Ruether. It is the usage of the term goddess. This approach builds off the feminist view that Judeo-Christian belief has masculinized terms referring to God when there is no need for it. She says that God is not a being removed from creation, ruling from outside in the manner of a patriarchal ruler. God is the source of being that underlines creation and grounds its nature and future potential for continual transformative renewal and biophilic mutuality. Its critique of idolatry means that the divine must be understood as both male and female, yet neither male nor female. This term has been adapted by many in effort to encompass all aspects of God without overlaying the traditional male or female roles to a God that is outside of these terms. Ruether's view of Christology is extremely critical. In her writing, Faith and Fratricide, she argues that there is a gap between what Jews thought about the Messiah and what the Church meant by the word Christ. She states that, once the mythology about Jesus as Messiah or divine Logos, with its traditional masculine imagery, is stripped off, the Jesus of the Synoptic Gospels can be recognized as a figure remarkably compatible with feminism. She also believes that, to rid itself of anti-Semitic tendency, the Church must radically re-examine its Christology. Particularly, Christians must no longer expect Jews to accept Jesus as their Messiah. Overall, she believes that most of the Christology we have today should be disregarded because it is not based on actual messianic beliefs and is only designed by a patriarchal community to oppress the marginalized. That leads us to the final area of theological discussion. Her belief about scripture and revelation. I leave this for last because after going over what we have, all of us starts to make sense when we look at her beliefs about this subject. Because she believes the patriarch has corrupted Christianity, she looks at the canon, or what we now have as the Bible, as a collection of resources used to control marginalized groups by suppressing other equally legitimate branches of the community. Because of this, most of her theological beliefs include what Christianity has considered pagan, heretical, those of ancient Near East, and other sources not used in the past. For Ruether, truth does not lie in the Bible, in the Church, or in theological beliefs. The actual truth is built upon experience. She says that the revelation is understood primarily to be experience, not the writings in the Bible or the Church doctrine. And when the Bible or Church go against experience, the Bible or the Church must be reworked and changed, since experience is what is most important. Whatever you believe about Ruether, you can't deny that she has heavily influenced the thought of many today. But that does not mean she has not been criticized for her beliefs. She has met criticism from those who hold conservative or traditional beliefs concerning things like Christology, Revelation, Scripture, etc. But she has also received criticism from many progressive people who have marked her connection to the church as primitive and point to her lack of racial and gender inclusions in her early movements for concern. Some of the most common critiques concerning her theology center on her beliefs about Scripture, Revelation, and claims of truth. Ed Miller and Stanley Grenz point out that Ruether does not provide adequate standards by which to judge competing claims of truth. If there is a patriarchal distortion in both Scripture and church pronouncements, then they ask the question, is the only remaining relatable source of God's revelation the original revelator experience? That makes the truth of a theological statement a highly subjective enterprise. If feminist theology is centered on feminist consciousness as its highest authority, as well as her experience to determine what is and is not normative in Scripture and Christian tradition, then nothing can be tested or proven. And their final criticism is that if critical principle is to solely be derived from a particular group, such as women, we have effectively eliminated any other criteria for engaging in self-criticism, and it runs the risk of merely replacing an old ideology with a new one. The second and last criticism I will mention comes from Linda Hogan, and she focuses on what it means to be labeled a Christian. She asks the question, to what extent can a theologian who views priority to women's experience and practice over and against texts and traditions considered to be foundational and thereby preeminent be considered Christian? Is there not a core which must remain, regardless of experience, if one wishes to call oneself Christian? Are all aspects hopelessly patriarchal? If so, what replaces them in a theology that identifies itself as Christian? Are there some popular scriptural interpretations or church teachings that are only minimally corroded by patriarchy? Hogan's main argument is that although Ruether has always proclaimed the need for the church and the importance of Christ, her theology leaves no need for it. There seems to be no basis for laying a groundwork for universal belief or any way of determining what it means to be a Christian. If experience and personal belief are the only determiner for discernment, then who can say whether what Ruether said was right or wrong? And this is the problem with much of her theology. But what do you think? For the question of the day, have you read any of Ruether's writings? And if so, what was your favorite? If you like this video, feel free to hit the like button and click the subscribe button and turn on that little bell notification to be alerted about new videos every week. And check out the description underneath the video for all the resources you'll need to learn about the life and work of Ruether. There are some videos on the screen if you're interested in watching some more of our videos. But I just wanted to say thanks for being here today, and I look forward to seeing you next Saturday for another informative and accessible introduction.